The First Minister's resignation has now taken effect, and in accordance with subsection 16B, brackets 2 of the Northern Ireland Act 1998, the Deputy First Minister has also ceased to hold office. The next item of business is the filling of both vacancies, and I will conduct this process in accordance with the procedures required by subsection 16B, brackets 3 of that Act. I will begin by asking the nominating officer of the largest political party of the largest political designation to nominate a member of the Assembly to be the First Minister. I will then ask the nominating officer of the largest political party of the second largest political designation to nominate a member of the Assembly to be the Deputy First Minister. As the persons nominated to fill the vacancy shall not take up office until each of them has affirmed the terms of the pledge of office contained in Schedule 4 of the Northern Ireland Act 1998. When I have received both nominations, I will ask each of the persons nominated to affirm the terms of the pledge of office. Before we proceed, members may find it helpful if the pledge of office is read into the record so that it does not have to be read in full by the persons nominated to the office of First Minister and Deputy First Minister. Clerk, please read the pledge of office.
The pledge of office is as follows: to pledge to discharge in good faith all the duties of office, commitment to non-violence and exclusively peaceful and democratic means, to serve all the people of Northern Ireland equally and to act in accordance with the general obligations on government to promote equality and prevent discrimination, to promote the interests of the whole community represented in the Northern Ireland Assembly towards the goal of a shared future, to participate fully in the Executive Committee, the North-South Ministerial Council and the British-Irish Council, to observe the joint nature of the offices of First Minister and Deputy First Minister, to uphold the rule of law based as it is on the fundamental principles of fairness, impartiality and democratic accountability, including support for policing of the courts as set out in paragraph 6 of the St Andrews Agreement, to participate with colleagues in the preparation of a programme for government, to operate within the framework of that programme when agreed within the Executive Committee and endorsed by the Assembly, to support and act in accordance with all decisions of the Executive Committee and Assembly, to comply with the Ministerial Code of Conduct. Paragraph 6 of the St Andrews Agreement says, "We believe that the essential elements of support for law and order include endorsing fully the Police Service of Northern Ireland and the criminal justice system, actively encouraging everyone in the community to cooperate fully with the PSNI in tackling crime in all areas and actively supporting all the policing and criminal justice institutions, including the Policing Board." Thank
you. And members, the pledge of office has now been read into the record of proceedings, and for information of members, copies are also available in the hall. So I will proceed now with the nomination process, and I call the Right Honourable Peter Robinson to nominate a member of the Assembly to be the First Minister. Mr Robinson.
Mr Speaker, it's a great pleasure and a huge honour for me in carrying out my last duty as nominating officer for the Democratic Unionist Party to nominate my good friend and my successor as party leader, Mrs Arlene Foster, to be First Minister of Northern Ireland. I know I'm only permitted to make a formal proposal at this stage, but I want to say that Arlene has been an excellent minister in each department in which she has served. She is eminently qualified for the post she is undertaking, and I am confident that she will continue to take Northern Ireland forward in the years to come. I have no doubt that she will apply her skill and judgment to great effect as First Minister, and I wish her every success and God's richest blessing as she faces this new challenge.
Thank you. And Mrs. Foster, are you willing to take up the office of First Minister?
Thank you very much, Mr Speaker. I affirm the terms of the pledge of office as set out in Schedule 4 to the Northern Ireland Act.
Thank you. You see, I was worried about all the reading you might have to do. And I have received a letter from the nominating officer of Sinn Féin advising me that Katrina Ryan will serve as nominating officer for the party today. And I call Ms Katrina Ryan to nominate a member of the Assembly to be the Deputy First Minister.
Agat agus bavian lum Martin Macanisa and you Marlas Privara. I would like to nominate Martin McGuinness as the Deputy First Minister. And as we know, the next few months are very important in the history of these institutions, the Assembly, North-South Bodies and British-Irish Council. And the public want to see our institutions delivering for people on the ground. They want to see us all working together. And they want this generation and future generations to benefit from peace. They want to see stability and more mature politics. We now have our Fresh Start Agreement, and I would pay tribute to Peter Robinson for the key role he played, along with Martin McGuinness and other political leaders. I worked with Peter when he was Minister for Finance and also First Minister. And I have to say, while we didn't always agree on issues, I do believe that we had a very polite, courteous and friendly relationship. And I would like to thank Peter for that. I also wish him and his family well in the coming months. I'm sure they'll be glad to get some time with him. I welcome Arlene Foster's nomination as First Minister. We look forward to working with Arlene and her team in the weeks and months ahead. I wish her all the best. And I think it is important that we acknowledge that it is historic that we have a woman in such an important office. And people will know that Paula and myself and many other women in this Assembly are really trying to ensure we have greater gender equality. And I think we'll all agree that today is a step forward in that. We want to see women right across the political spectrum taking up our rightful places. Martin McGuinness is a man that I have worked with for many years. I consider him a friend. He is ethical, principled, and has shown incredible leadership. He is also generous on a personal and political level. He uses his good office to outreach across all political classes and creeds. And most recently, Martin and Peter led the way in welcoming refugees to our shores. As a mother and a grandmother, I understand just how difficult it is for families of politicians, and without family support, this job would not be possible. I would like to thank Bernie, Martin's wife, his four children, Grania, Fionnuala, Fiachra and Emmett, and his seven grandchildren, Chirna, Cara, Rasa, Oisín, Kiana, Dúlta and Saive, for sharing Martin with us. I have no doubt, as I make this nomination, that Martin will continue to show leadership, to be a Deputy First Minister for all the people, and to build a strong relationship with Arlene Foster in the same way as he did with Ian Paisley and Peter Robinson.
Thank you. And Mr. McGuinness, are you willing to take up the office of Deputy First Minister and affirm the terms of the pledge of office?
Katrina. Yes, I affirm the term of the pledge of office as set out in Schedule 4 to the Northern Ireland Act in 1998.
Thank you. I now confirm that Mrs. Arlene Foster and Mr. Martin McGuinness, having affirmed the terms of the pledge of office, have taken up office as First Minister and Deputy First Minister in accordance with Section 16B of the Northern Ireland Act 1998. And I offer my warmest congratulations to you both and wish you well for the future. There will now be an opportunity for members to comment, and I will begin by calling the First Minister and then the Deputy First Minister to address the House. Mrs. Arlene Foster, the First Minister.
Mr. Speaker, it is with great humility and an enormous sense of responsibility and indeed the imagination of endless potential for Northern Ireland that I affirm the pledge of office and take up this post today. I can think of no greater honour than to have the opportunity to serve my country and the people of Northern Ireland as their First Minister. I am truly humbled by the trust and confidence which has been placed in me and grateful for all those who have kept me in their prayers in recent days. As a young girl growing up in rural Fermanagh, the most westerly constituency in the whole of the United Kingdom, in the days when we were plagued by terrorism and decisions affecting our fates and our futures were taken far away, I could not have dreamt that I would be in this position today. Is it any wonder that in politics I believe nothing is impossible? But the real measure of success is not in obtaining the office, but how it enables me to help others realise their dreams ambitions and aspirations. For my part, I want to make sure what is possible for me is possible for any young girl or boy growing up in Northern Ireland. And for so many reasons, this is an historic moment. I take great pride in the fact that since Northern Ireland was created almost a century ago, I am the first woman to hold such a post. It was with even greater trepidation still that I learned I'm also the youngest person to have assumed this post. I hope that I can bring the perspectives that both these attributes have to the office. Indeed, at this turning point in our country's history, as we seek to address the challenges of the future, I believe the moment is right for the next generation to assume leadership. The challenges that this generation face are very different to those our forefathers did a century ago, but our fundamental values remain the same. The challenges in just 5 years' time will be different again. And though I may be the youngest holder of this post, Mr. Speaker, I am not new to ministerial office. You will be aware that this is not the first time that I have taken the pledge of office, but over this past 8 years have done so as Environment Minister, the Economy Minister, and most recently as Finance Minister. I have learned much in those roles that I will bring to my new office, but I will be forever grateful for the opportunity that both Dr. Paisley and Peter Robinson gave to me to serve the community in ministerial office and the rich legacy that I am inheriting in this office. That experience has prepared me for the challenges that will undoubtedly lie ahead. Last autumn, we published the Fresh Start Agreement, and today we make a new start with our eyes focused firmly on the future. But in looking to the future, we will never forget the past. I am conscious of those who have not lived to see today, and of course, I think particularly of my father, who would have been so proud of what has been achieved. I also think of all those who served the community in the security forces during the dark days of the Troubles and those whose lives were cut all too short. And I make this promise, in all I do, I will honour their memory. Amen. We are all shaped by our history and our experience. Many of us live with the scars, emotional and real, of what we had to endure. Far too often during my earlier years of life, I saw the devastating effect that terrorism and violence had on our community. We cannot, however, allow the past to forever blight our future. That's why I want to make sure that we never, ever go back to the bad old days. I believe that the duty on me to make Northern Ireland work is all the greater for the sacrifice that they have made. The reward and legacy of those who gave their lives defending our country is a stable and secure Northern Ireland within the United Kingdom. Yeah. I also pay tribute to those who have served our community so well in positions of leadership over the last decades. It is because of what they have done that we have the hope for the future that we do. They have laid the foundations for the new Northern Ireland that we are seeking to build. But at this moment in our country's history, it is time for a new generation to step forward, to build on all that has been achieved and to move our country forward. Abraham Lincoln once said, "The best way to predict your future is to create it." That is our responsibility now, to create a better future than the past and one where we can live together in a society free of strife and conflict. The challenges of our time are great, but they are different than in the past. The challenges of our time are great, but the opportunities for the next generation are greater still. The challenges of our time are great, but there are none that we cannot overcome. With Northern Ireland's position in the United Kingdom secured, with devolution safeguarded and the economy growing again, we can have hope for the future. Over the years, people from this small corner of the world have done remarkable things, and we can do that again. In my role as the Economy Minister for 7 years, I travelled the world seeking to bring jobs and investment home. In that time, I am proud that we created more jobs from international investment than at any time in our past. One thing that made that easy was the quality of our young people. And when I travel across Northern Ireland, I see people with abundant gifts and talents, sometimes held back by nothing but a lack of confidence and a poverty of ambition. The only thing that they lack is belief. And I want to use this office to restore that belief and to give new hope. I want to instill a new confidence in our people and a pride in our province. I want everyone to love this country with the same passion that I do. Leadership has many facets and many responsibilities, but there is no greater challenge than to motivate and to encourage and to inspire. And I want to bring hope to those who lack it and help to those who need it. I want us to live in a more harmonious society where we seek accommodation with one another and not conflict. Those in positions of responsibility in government cannot do everything, but we can act as an example to others. If only we believe in ourselves, all things are possible. Mr. Speaker, I make no apology for being a unionist, but as in my role as First Minister calls on me to serve the whole community. I see that not just as a legal duty, but as a moral imperative. I want the same opportunities for every child in Northern Ireland as my own. I want no section or part of the community in Northern Ireland to be isolated, marginalised or left behind, whatever their background or way of life. That was Edward Carson's vision of the Union, and it's mine too. The best way to safeguard our history and culture and traditions is to make sure that we can create a society in which everyone can have a say and play a part. That's why it's no coincidence that support for our constitutional position has never been stronger. I believe in Northern Ireland and the people of Northern Ireland. We are a special people. People ask me, what do I want to achieve in office during my time? My answer is simple. Like every mother, I am a practical person. Above all else, I want the future. I want to move into the future and I want to get things done. I want to make Northern Ireland a better place and I want to strengthen our United Kingdom. I want to give our young people the future that has been denied to so many for so long. I want Northern Ireland to be a beacon to the world of how, by working together with political opponents and old enemies, we can create a Northern Ireland that we can all be proud of. I want to do all of that, not in spite of my own past, but because of it. I will work with anyone who can share that ambition of hope and will oppose anyone who would deny our people the future that they deserve. The people we represent deserve no less. I'm tired of Stormont being a watchword for arguing and bickering, and that's not why our people elected us. They did so to provide a better future for us all. And I will do all that I can to change the political culture of this place, but I can't change it alone. We can only do it by working together. And I know from experience it won't be easy, because real change never is. But I ask today that we find a new way of doing business, one that places a greater premium on consensus rather than conflict. Mr. Speaker, it is with great honour that today I accept the nomination to become First Minister. It is truly humbling that the girl who was raised and reared in Fermanagh has been given the opportunity to lead the country and the people she loves so much. Today is a new chapter in Northern Ireland's story, but when the history of this time comes to be written, let it be said of all of us that we fought the good fight, we finished the race, and we have kept the faith. Thank you.
Thank you. And I now call Deputy First Minister, Mr. Martin McGuinness.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Can I first of all say that I too am very thankful and appreciative to my party for the renomination as Deputy First Minister. And as we say goodbye to Peter Robinson and wish him well and his family well into the future, similarly, as Arlene Foster takes over as First Minister, we wish her and her family well also. I'm very conscious that Arlene's mother and her husband and children are here today. And I also acknowledge the hurt that their family endured as a result of the conflict. And it's important, I think, that we do acknowledge that hurt, because, of course, we on this side of the House also have been hurt, losing neighbours and friends as a result of the conflict. What we have done in ending that conflict has been remarkable, and it hasn't been down to one or two people to do that. It took a combined effort from all. So I pledge a positive spirit, a constructive spirit, and a good heart in working with Arlene as First Minister through these important and historic times. Like Katrina, I am delighted to see women elevated into the highest positions in government. I have been very privileged to work with exceptional Republican women ministers like Barbara de Bruyn, Michelle Gildernew, Katrina, Martina Anderson, Carolyn Cullen, Michelle O'Neill, and Jennifer McCann. I think it is important that we all recognise the role of women within politics and do everything in our power to ensure that people who are highly talented have every opportunity to move forward and contribute, as they clearly do, to our political development. We have huge challenges in the time ahead. We have the Fresh Start Agreement. It is an agreement that I believe propels us forward if we implement it, and that's the big challenge, as George Mitchell said at the time of the Good Friday Agreement. It's one thing forging an agreement, it's a whole other enterprise implementing the agreement. But I think this is a real opportunity to move forward, to move away from the negativity of the last couple of years, and to try and deliver for the people that we represent. Let me say this. As far as we as Irish Republicans are concerned, unionists are not the enemy. Loyalists are not the enemy. Who are the enemy? The enemy is poverty. The enemy is inequality. The enemy is unemployment. The enemy is denial of rights. The enemy is intolerance. The enemy is sectarianism. The enemy is racism. And the enemy is homophobia. And the enemy is violence. And we know, to our cost and to the cost of people who have lost their lives in recent years, even against the backdrop of the peace agreements that we have forged, that there are still people out there on all sides who are committed to plunging us back to the past. Well, I believe that there is a total determination within this Assembly across all the political parties to show the futility of that effort to those who would try to do that. I'm a proud Irish Republican, and this is an important year for Irish Republicanism with the 100th anniversary of the Easter Rising. And I know there are different views about all of that. It's also an important year for unionism in terms of the Battle of the Somme, also the 100th anniversary. And how we conduct ourselves through these vital anniversaries over the course of the next number of years, I think will tell the international community a lot about how we are as people. I am pledged to do everything in my power to ensure that we all conduct ourselves very dignified, very respectful in terms of how we move forward, recognising the different emotions that are out there. Arlene is committed to the continuation of what she calls the United Kingdom. And I am a committed Irish Republican dedicated to the reunification of Ireland by purely peaceful and democratic means. There is absolutely no diminution of Arlene's unionism or my republicanism by us working together in the interests of all of our people. And whenever we talk about how we can break down divisions, it's not just about breaking down divisions between our communities or between ourselves as political leaders. It's also breaking down divisions between North and South that have been so much to our detriment. And we all know that working economically on an all-island agenda doesn't in any way diminish our allegiances to the different political aspirations that we have. So this is a time of great change, and I look forward to working with Arlene in the time ahead. Somebody said to me, well, quite a number of people said to me over the last few weeks, how are you going to work with Arlene Foster? And I said, well, if you can work with Ian Paisley and Peter Robinson, you can work with anybody. I don't have any doubt that Arlene and I will have a good personal relationship and a good working relationship. And I look forward to engaging with her on the vital issues that affect all of our people. Gurumila Mila Mayogat.
Thank you. And as I indicated earlier, there will now be an opportunity for others to speak, and the Business Committee has agreed a maximum time limit of 30 minutes and that members would limit their remarks to not more than 3 minutes. Again, I have the names of some members who have already indicated they wish to speak, but could I ask all members who would like to contribute to continue to rise in their places, and I will endeavour to accommodate as many as possible. And as previously, the briefer you are, the more opportunity there will be for others. Could I begin by calling the Lord Morrow?
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. It's with considerable pleasure that I rise to make some comments in relation to the elevation of Arlene Foster today to the position of First Minister. And I do that for a number of reasons, not least because she is my colleague in Fermanagh South Tyrone, and she has been one whom I've got to know quite well since she came into politics, and in particular into the DUP. And I would like to say to the House today that Arlene Foster, I have no doubt, will do a sterling job, not because she simply comes from Fermanagh, but that would be a good enough reason, but simply say that she has all the attributes that such a position will need. Arlene Foster has demonstrated very, very clearly that she is a person with foresight and leadership qualities, and I think that as a result of what has happened here today, Northern Ireland will be a better place, and she will continue in the same vein that Peter Robinson has been doing, and she will lead Northern Ireland forward. Arlene comes from a county that has had more than its share of bad news in the past, and indeed her own family was at the cutting edge of that. Her father came under severe attack as an RUC officer. And of course Arlene, as we have been learning in the past, was also on that school bus that day, and as a young student going or coming from the collegiate, she was not afraid to give her views on the media in relation to what was planned that day. And I believe that the hand of God was upon her also and upon her colleagues. And I believe it's no coincidence that Arlene Foster is now the First Minister here in Northern Ireland. In his remarks, Mike Nesbitt played a very full and fulsome tribute to Peter Robinson. However, there was just one wee thing he got wrong, and I want him to pay attention to that. And I'd like to say this, that he made the comment that Peter had led this party to a phenomenal success of 38 seats, but he hoped that that would be a high watermark. Mike Nesbitt, I say this in as nice a way as I can say it to you. You have seen nothing yet.
Yeah.
Because today this party has a leader and this assembly has a First Minister who will take the eyes off you. You keep your eye on her, because I can tell you what, she is going to run you out of breath. And how do I know that? Because I am her colleague in Fermanagh South Tyrone, and I have good reason to believe that. And I wish Arlene Foster well today. And I know the future is bright for Northern Ireland. And I believe what she wants for those of us in the DUP, she wants for everybody in Northern Ireland, not only in County Fermanagh, but right across this whole province. And I believe her real desire is to bring prosperity and peace and good government to Northern Ireland, and I wish her well in the future.
Thank you. And I call Mr. John O'Dowd.
Firstly, rise to add to my to the remarks made about Mr. Robson on his retirement. I want to endorse those. But I particularly want to comment on the election of the First and Deputy First Minister. Both Arlene and Martin, and the contribution they have already made to politics in this society and changes in this society, and the changes they can make going into the future. Martin is an old hand at this in many ways now, but his enthusiasm, his determination and his leadership continues to gain not only my party, but also this society. And the friendship, the trust and the leadership that grew up between himself and Peter Robinson saved this pillar of the peace process from collapse in recent weeks and months. Because many in this room will realise, but perhaps others outside this room do not realise, that this pillar of the peace process, the Assembly, was finished. But there was wiser heads took and prevailed, and Martin and Peter were to the forefront of that. And that leadership role, that trust, that friendship, that determination will have to be built between Mrs Foster and Martin going into the future. Because there are many, many enemies of the peace process in our society, and they don't all wear balaclavas. We faced huge challenges from many, many different quarters, and it will take strong leadership, like was seen over this last number of months between Peter and Martin, to see us through those days as well. In a recent interview, Mrs Foster used the quote which now hangs in the Assembly from C.S. Lewis: "There are far, far better things ahead than we leave behind." And I'm sure she wasn't referring to Mr Robinson's leadership, but referring to the terrible events that plagued our lives over this last 40 years. And I have no doubt far, far better things lie ahead of us, but it will take the determination of everyone in this room to make that happen. And I often reflect on those in leadership positions. At times it has to be a very, very lonely place to be, a very, very difficult place to be, because it's very easy to sit in the corner and tell everybody what you shouldn't be doing or what they would do if they were in leadership. But the fact of the matter is this: when you're in a leadership position, the buck stops with you. Now, perhaps in our society here, there's an advantage to the joint office of First and Deputy First Minister, because we have seen, despite the difficulties we have faced over this many years, that when the joint office of the First and Deputy First Minister work together, we achieve real change in our society, and we achieve real differences in people's lives. Yes, there's huge challenges ahead. There's huge economic challenges ahead. There's huge social challenges ahead. And as I already mentioned, there's challenges from those who want to bring down this institution. But I'll end on a quote from Seamus Heaney: "Believe that a further shore is reachable from here." And as Mrs Foster will know, when the deluge comes, the shore looks further away. But I believe that by Martin and Arlene working together, we will be able to reach that further shore.
And I call Mr Colin Eastwood.
Thank you, Mr Speaker, and can I join with others in congratulating Arlene Foster in her new position, and also Martin McGuinness and continuing on as Deputy First Minister. In our view, it's a joint position, and I think it's very important to note that Mrs Foster is the first woman to hold that position. I think it's another glass ceiling in the North has been smashed, and I'm very glad to see it. I also welcome very much her very positive speech today about the renewal of politics, about a new generation stepping forward. In our party, we recognise that as well, and we are beginning that process. Whilst we all wish you all the best today, there will be no honeymoon period. I'm sure you're aware of that. And I spent quite a bit of time on Saturday in your own constituency up to my knees in water, and I think one of your first duties will be to try and develop long-term solutions to those problems, because there are people in Fermanagh and other parts of the North who have been underwater since the 5th of December. I don't think it's good enough in this day and age that that can still continue to happen. Her predecessor's first words, I think, on the first days of this mandate was to say that we would be judged by delivery. I think she and I would probably disagree about how good that delivery has actually been in this mandate, but we do need to get to a position where we are — this place is judged on delivery — where we are setting out positive agendas for the future, and we are actually making change that people can touch and feel and understand. It is good to see that our two first ministers are now from west of the Bann. The people that I represent and the people that I'm sure they represent will be glad to hear that. But we'll wait and see what that means in terms of delivery for those people. But I wish them all the best. Mrs Foster talked about the fact that we're all shaped by our history. I think she's obviously been shaped by her own personal experience, but we are, as a people, all shaped by our history. That history does include the events of 100 years ago, and I would like to see all the leaders of this place engage positively and respectfully, and not necessarily, if they can't, celebrating events, but commemorating them and learning from them and thinking and talking and planning for the next 100 years, Mr. Speaker. And with that, I wish both First Ministers all the best in their endeavours.
Mr. Mike Nesbitt.
Mr. Speaker, thank you very much. Let me begin by congratulating Mrs. Foster on her personal achievement. The youngest, as she says, younger just than James Chichester Clark, and of course the first female First Minister. And I know recently she's quoted Maren Allsop, the American musician who became the first female to conduct the last night of the proms, and reacted by saying she looked forward to the time when these things were so commonplace they were no longer newsworthy. And I can certainly join with the First Minister in supporting that. Now, of course, Mrs. Foster has the baton, and we await to see what sort of music she can squeeze out of an often discordant executive, an executive just of four parties these days, only two of whom support the budget, only two of whom support the self-styled A Fresh Start. So the First Minister clearly has challenges internally, but challenges externally as well, of course. Northern Ireland and our people have many unmet needs. They seek a healthier and a more prosperous future. And I note that, of course, the people of Northern Ireland... I note that from recent remarks, Mrs. Foster, like me, is focusing on offering a vision. But, of course, Northern Ireland, the people and the other parties of the executive bought into a vision in 1998. Mrs. Foster did not. And I remember flying her to London for an Ulster television debate ahead of the referendum in Downing Street with Prime Minister Blair. And I well remember at dinner afterwards she reacted to the praise she was being given for her articulate stance by saying she well believed it was the end of her career as a member of the Ulster Unionist Party. And some, of course, will see it as ironic that she's now living that vision in these very institutions. We will, of course, not always agree, and indeed we appear to disagree over how you mark the significance of the 1916 Easter Rebellion, but that's for another day. Today is about wishing our new First Minister well in her new role, not least under the now intolerable pressure she's been put under by the Lord Morrow. And, of course, we wish the Deputy First Minister Martin McGuinness well. I believe we are to debate soon in Bundoran, which I think for an Ulster Unionist represents an away fixture, but I look forward to it nevertheless.
Thank you, and I call Mr. Stephen Farley.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Can I start by first of all recognising the contribution that Peter Robinson has played to politics in Northern Ireland over the best part of four decades, and wishing him a very long and happy retirement. And indeed, his fate and indeed the fate of the Alliance Party have been intertwined for better or worse for many years, particularly over the past number of years as well. But we do wish him every success and happiness in terms of his future. Can I then therefore move to congratulating Arlene Foster on her appointment as First Minister, and also Martin McGuinness on his reappointment as Deputy First Minister. I'm not sure who's the more surprised with that particular outcome, but we do indeed recognise the importance of today and the significance of today. Can I say, with particular reference to Arlene Foster, as she is the new incumbent in terms of the joint top office in our society, that I certainly have known her for many years. Indeed, our paths crossed when we were Queens, probably the best part of a quarter of a century ago. I'm sure she won't thank me for referencing it in those terms. Of course, back then, her and indeed many of her colleagues who are also in this building today were in a different youth wing of a political party, but that is a sign of the evolution in terms of our politics over that time. Can I reassure her that I cannot recall at this stage any particular skeletons from her time at Queen's? So if I if my memory does serve me well, I'll be first, I will let her know the first in that regard. A lot of comment has been made in terms of the historic importance of today's events from a number of angles, in particular the fact that we have a joint leader who the first time is female, and indeed that is truly historic, and it's important that that now acts as a spur to greater participation on a gender basis across our society. It doesn't always follow that when the leader of a society is female that that percolates down to other aspects of public life and indeed the business life and civic life in society. So there is a challenge in that regard, and while we are making great strides in terms of participation, there is a way to go in terms of progression in that regard. Can I say that the Alliance will work very closely with the new First Minister and the returned Deputy First Minister, both in terms of the Executive and the Assembly, particularly when they are acting in an inclusive way and are acting and articulating a common good and a common vision for this society. Undoubtedly, we have many challenges on the road ahead, economically, socially, environmentally, and in particular in terms of genuinely building a shared future and tackling problems in terms of the rule of law. We are up for those challenges, and we're happy to work in collaboration with others whenever they share that common vision. Thank you very much.
Very much, and I call Mr. Mervyn Storey.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Today undoubtedly is a day for saying it's a day of mixed emotions. As we come to this House, we come recognising that we have had many historic occasions in this chamber. Lord Morrow, my long-standing friend and colleague, said to me when I came to this House in 2003 that nothing remains the same. There's always change. And today we see the outworking of that change. I want to say on a personal basis to my friend and colleague Peter Robinson a sincere word of thanks and appreciation for all that he has done for Northern Ireland. And in saying to Peter a fond farewell but not goodbye, it is with the greatest joy that we say a fond welcome to Arlene Foster as becoming the First Minister of Northern Ireland and the leader of unionism. I joined this party, the DUP, over 36 years ago, and I have no doubt that the leadership of Ian Paisley and Peter Robinson formulated a formidable duo in the history of Northern Ireland. But Arlene Foster takes on that mantle in a way which I believe reflects her ability and the vision that she has for Northern Ireland. She is someone who has undoubtedly proved her capabilities, not because of her gender, but because of the person that she is, because of the qualities that she has, and because of the history that has helped to formulate her as an individual. I have worked with Arlene over the last number of years, and I find her to be someone of the highest integrity and someone who is extremely personable and approachable. And I have no doubt, Arlene, as you take on the role as you have today of First Minister, you will do it in the way that you have to date displayed your capabilities in the ministerial portfolios that you have held. Northern Ireland is today a better place. When I grew up as a young person, the news was dominated by the latest atrocity, by the latest murder, by the mayhem, by the division of our society. But today, as we enter 2016, we have a relevant peace in Northern Ireland. Our communities are seeking and endeavouring to come together. I have no doubt that that is the legacy of Peter Robinson, and it is that baton, it is that mantle that I have every confidence that Arlene Foster today will pick up and will run with to ensure that Northern Ireland continues to be a prosperous place. It was Solomon who said, and I conclude, and it's words of wisdom that we all do well to heed. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not unto thine own understanding, but in all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths. The Lord bless you, Arlene, in the future. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call Ms. Claire Sugden.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. First, I want to wish the outgoing First Minister well in his retirement, and also wish the Deputy First Minister, Martin McGuinness, on his reappointment. But today, for me, Mr. Speaker, is all about one woman, and that's Arlene Foster. She's not a good politician. To be fair, she's a great politician, and she is also a woman. And today, she's First Minister. The first female First Minister of Northern Ireland. I think this is incredible, and I'm inspired. And I hope young women, in fact all women across Northern Ireland, will be inspired too. Today we are beginning a new generation, a necessary new generation of political leaders in Northern Ireland, a generation that welcomes and encourages young women into politics. Mr. Speaker, she's not just the right woman for the job, she's the right person for the job. And it is a milestone that now two of three of the First Ministers of our devolved nations are women. Today we have ensured that capable female leaders are acknowledged alongside their male counterparts. Mrs. Foster demonstrates this well. I disagree with Mrs. Foster on many things, and I will continue to be critical from this back corner telling you what you're doing wrong, because that's my job indeed. She would expect it from me, and surely she should expect it from all MLAs in this House. But I see it as a point of reference to do better. And I would say to Mrs. Foster to embrace that challenge because she's earned it. I sincerely wish her well in her new role, driving Northern Ireland forward into a new positive space for Northern Ireland. Because the most important aspect of leadership is not the leader, but rather the people behind the leader, the followers, the people of Northern Ireland. And the people of Northern Ireland deserve better. They deserve better than this past year. And I hope today is the beginning of better. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. And the call, Mr. John McAllister.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And I would like to begin by paying tribute to the outgoing First Minister and to wish him health and happiness for a long and prosperous retirement, whatever. And I'm sure his successor will, from time to time, want his wise counsel and his advice. And certainly, as I've said before, I think it's his last question time. In all the personal dealings I've had, in either seeking meetings for constituents, or indeed in progression of my own private member's bill, the First Minister has extended time and courtesy to me in that period, and I'm grateful to him for that. I would say when in the earlier debate there was reference made to the former First Minister's speech, one of the Peter Robinson speeches that most struck a chord with me was, I think it was from his 2011 party conference speech, when he said we're going to end us and them. And I think that remains the big challenge for the new First Minister, for the Deputy First Minister, to really get to work in ending those divisions. I would like to offer my warmest congratulations to Arlene Foster as First Minister. I've no doubt that she brings huge ministerial experience now in politics for somebody of my own generation, shall I say. I'm not sure she wants to be reminded that she's a couple of years older, but she's it is interesting to think that there is, Mr. Speaker, almost a generational shift now, in that most of the DUP ministers are all people who were born in the 1970s. That is a shift in age that says that Northern Ireland is progressing and is moving, and all of or a great amount of the what has gone before is being put in the past, and we are looking to a brighter future. I would say the challenge again is to end the us and them. In our politics and right across our society, and I do wish Ms. Foster and Mr. McGuinness well in addressing that. And I would say in both their contributions they talked about their unionism and their republicanism. I would say to both of them, the key in doing all of this, whether unionist or republican, is to make Northern Ireland work.
I call Mr. Simon Hamilton.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, can I begin by echoing earlier tributes to Peter? This party, this Assembly, and indeed Northern Ireland as a whole has a lot to be thankful for Peter's service down through the last 40 years. And can I thank him, and I'm sure we would all wish to thank him and his family for his service and the sacrifice that they have all collectively made down through the years. Today is a significant day for Arlene and her family. Today is a significant day, as other members have mentioned, for women in Northern Ireland. And Colm Leasewood talked about a glass ceiling having been broken. Well, the Arlene Foster that we know, for her, there is no glass ceiling. And if there was a ceiling, she would bust right through it, as she has done today. Now, I have known Arlene for many years, not just as many as Mr. Farry and others have known her, but probably the best part of 20 years. And when you know somebody for that long, you get to know them pretty well. And what I've learned over the years about Arlene, and I think which is most relevant about today and taking up the post of First Minister, is the fact that she loves Northern Ireland greatly. She has an abiding love for this place and for its people. And I think given the important role that she has taken up in leading everyone in Northern Ireland, it's important that she has that attribute. And she's, of course, displayed all of her other many abilities down through the years in this place as various ministers, including Environment Minister, Finance Minister, and also as Economy Minister. And particularly in that role of Economy Minister, she stood up for and went out around the world, as she said, fighting for Northern Ireland, trying to bring investment to here. And it is that type of role of standing up for Northern Ireland on a global stage, which will be incredibly important in her role as First Minister as well. Like many of us, I know that Arlene believes that as great as Northern Ireland has been throughout the near 100-year history of this place, in spite of all of the challenges that we have faced, that our best days still lie ahead. And at this time in the history of Northern Ireland, I think we are fortunate to be led by somebody of the calibre of Arlene, with her stature, with her experience. And I am confident, as I know many others will be confident, that Arlene will continue to lead Northern Ireland on our journey to better days. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call Mr. Edmund Poots.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and can I rise to congratulate my friend and colleague Arlene Foster on her elevation to First Minister. I was one of those who welcomed Arlene into the DUP back in 2003 in Lisburn Orange Hall. That night there was about 500 of us packed in, and it was a tremendous demonstration of leadership on the part of herself and Geoffrey Donaldson in terms of where we were going in Northern Ireland. And I would suggest to Mr. Nesbitt and them that the die has been cast ever since that period of time, and the people have demonstrated that in vote after vote. But in congratulating Arlene on her elevation to First Minister, I would say that is the second most important job that she will ever take on. Her most important job has been and will remain as that of a wife, a mother, a daughter, and family will always become first. And I know that will be the case with Arlene and should be the case. But I think that it is a really positive day for Northern Ireland in that we have a new First Minister to lead us forward. And, you know, in looking at the attributes that Arlene has for the office, she's feisty and she's fiery and she's passionate, but she's also intelligent and articulate, and she's also compassionate and caring. And I think that anybody who takes up a role like that needs to embody all of those things. And in doing the job that she has to take on, and being in the coalition that we happen to be in, and I got a bit of flack from some people for saying that we hold our noses to work with Sinn Féin, and that's something that was commonly used in the last Westminster Parliament between the Conservatives and Liberal Democrats. Sinn Féin are not our first choice in terms of coalition partners, but the people make the decisions, and the people decide who gets the seats. And if the people decide that Sinn Féin are going to have the number of seats that puts them there, we will get on with the job that the people task us to do. And I know that Arlene will go in there and she'll be tough on occasions. And there's other occasions when we will seek to drive things forward together and projects forward together because it is in the wider public interest. And I've absolutely no doubt that what we are doing is in the wider public interest and that we will do the job well. and Arlene will give us the leadership in doing that job. Mr. Nesbitt referred to the musical analogy and about Arlene holding the baton, and I would suggest to Mr. Nesbitt that in this instance he may be the drum and to expect a good beating.
Thank you, members, and time is up. And the